cross of Calvary.
Oh,
was walking down life's highway.
All right.
A long time ago.
Yeah.
When I saw a sign that read Heaven's Grocery Store. As I came a little closer, the door came open wide. When I came to myself, I was standing inside. I saw a host of angels. They were standing everywhere. One handed me a basket and said, "My child, shop with care." Now, everything a Christian needed was in that grocery store, and all you couldn't carry, you could come back the next day for more. First, I got some love, and patience was in the same row. All further down was understanding. You need that everywhere you go. So I got a box of wisdom and a bag or two of faith, for I just couldn't miss the Holy Ghost, for he was all over the place. I shopped for strength and courage to help me run this race. By then, my basket was getting full, and I remember I needed some grace. I didn't forget salvation, as I said, because it was there for us, and it was free. So I tried to get enough to save both you and me. So I started down the aisle to pay my grocery bill, for I thought I had everything to do my master's will. And I happened to see prayer, and I had to put it in, for I knew when I stepped outside, I walked right back into sin. Peace and joy were plentiful. They were hanging on the last shelf. Songs and praises were near, so I just helped myself. So I got to the counter, and I asked the angel, "How much do I owe?" He just looked at me and said, "Take them with you everywhere you go." And I asked him again, "No, stop the press, stop the press. How much do I, Kewon McKenzie Foster, senior owes?" And he looked at me and smiled and said, "My child, Jesus paid your bill a long, long time ago." Amen. Paid the bill. Already done. Already done. I like to be obedient to the Holy Spirit. And you see your program. You see what it says for the message. But the Spirit of God has moved me to look at a different vantage as we look at the Word of God this morning. I want to take two passages of Scripture and together it's just four verses. And I want to speak from these verses this morning. I want to look at Isaiah chapter 53 and simply read verses 4 through 7. Isaiah chapter 53, verses 4 through 7. And then I just want us to run over to Romans chapter 6, verse 23. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Isaiah chapter 53, verses 4 through 7. And the Word of God reads as such. Surely, he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed. He was afflicted. Yet he opened not his mouth, like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, like a sheep that before its shearers is silent. So he opened not his mouth. I want you to look at also Romans chapter 6, verse 23, and it reads, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." I want to speak to us on the subject of simply pain. In full.
All right.
Paid in full.
All right, bro.
In order for you to take out legally any merchandise from a department store,
all right,
When you get to the counter, it is expected that you will submit your method of payment, whether that be cash, check, credit card, or debit card. The cashier is going to ring up your merchandise and is going to expect that you are going to pay for your items. And they're not going to expect that you are going to just submit to them a partial payment. No, if that bill says that it's $150 for them nice Gator shoes that you bought, if that bill says it's $250 for that nice purse that you purchased, then the cashier is going to expect for you to pay your bill in full. And if you try to leave the store without paying your bill in full, then if they have security guards on hand, as old Otis from Martin used to say, you going down today, boy. Because they will come and get you. When sin entered into the world, through the disobedience of both Adam and Eve, we became merchandise inside Satan's department store. Now, some of us may not want to recognize that, but I thank God that I serve a God who is the final authority on all things. And God says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And we all stand guilty as charged. And we all were merchandise inside Satan's store. This is one of the reasons why the devil, as y'all heard me say before in past times, knows so much about us. Oh, he knows what buttons to push to get you moving in his direction. He knows just where to rub you to get you uncomfortable. He knows us. We used to be his merchandise. But one day, a man named Jesus came in to the department store, came up to the counter, and he submitted a payment, and he didn't pull out a wallet with money inside for what our price was to be redeemed.
That's right.
No money could take care of it. But the price that he paid, the price was his life. For Hebrews 9:22 says that almost all things by the law are purged with blood. And without the shedding of blood, there could be no remission, that is, forgiveness of sin. The problem is sin, something that we don't like to talk about. You see, nowadays we have trivialized or downplayed sin by giving it nice and little cute little names. And instead of saying that a person committed adultery, we say you committed affair. That just kind of sounds a little bit better. It don't sound as devilish. You hear what I'm saying? But sin is sin. And when you look in the Old Testament and you look in the Garden of Eden, that before Adam and Eve were cast out of the garden, the Bible said that God took innocent animals who did no wrong, and he sacrificed them and covered Adam and Eve and expelled them out of the garden.
That's right.
And when you look in the Old Testament, you see that God was so serious about sin that God said, in order for you, your sins to be pardoned temporarily, God says, I require a life. Something has to die, because we just read that the wages of sin is death. So God says something. something has to die. So he set up a sacrificial system where the people could have forgiveness from their sins temporarily.
All right.
As long as they offered up the appropriate sacrifice that God commanded for them to offer up.
My God.
Everything that we read in the Old Testament, as the writer in Hebrews said, was simply a foreshadow. For God was just simply getting us ready for when he will send the ultimate lamb, the ultimate sacrifice. Because God said this, the blood of lambs and bull and goats can't take away your devilish sins. I need something more pure, something more potent. I don't want to just cover your sins, but I want to forgive and take away as far as the east is from the west. And Jesus came and paid it in full. I believe that we really don't take the time to seriously consider and think about what Jesus actually had to go through.
That's right.
When resurrection comes, we are so fast to get to him rising or raising from the grave that we don't take the time to sit there and cogitate or ruminate or ponder and just sit there and think about what he actually had to endure.
That's right.
The suffering. See, if truth be told, none of us sit here. We don't stand around during the day or at work or in social circles or at home talking about suffering. Who in the world wants to do that? I want to talk about how the Miami Heat don't three-peat this year. Ain't that right, Chris? I see you back. Ain't that right, Chris? Yeah. You know, I want to talk about some other thing. I don't want to talk about no suffering.
All right.
But there's no way we can get to him being resurrected without drawing attention to the suffering that he endured. And if you don't mind, as we look at this subject of paid in full, I want to do my best through the Holy Spirit to take us through the scenes and to look closely at what Jesus had to really go through before he even got to the cross. He had already started to suffer for Luke tells us in his gospel that as Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, which literally means olive press, he was in a place of pressing. And how fitting that our Lord Jesus, at one of the most critical times in his life, a life where he has anxiety and turmoil and anguish, finds himself in a place of pressing. Luke said that Jesus was in such anguish and such distress that he began to literally sweat blood. Now, raise your hand if you've ever been that stressed out. See, we say things like, Lord, these kids are stressing me out. My boss stressing me out. I'm about to lose my mind. But if you don't know stress until you start literally sweating blood. And Dr. Luke was not speaking in figurative language, because we are told by medical doctors that this condition is actually a medical condition called hemotidrosis, which typically happens when one finds themselves in an intense, stressful, and anguished situation that they begin to sweat blood. That before any blood was spilled on Calvary, blood already start coming forth in Gethsemane as God was pressing him and getting him ready. Jesus was so overtaken in emotion that the text says that he came and he told the disciples, can you just stay here? Pray with me a little longer. Y'all stay here and I'm gonna go in and I'm gonna pray it. And he prayed it and he came back, and the Bible tells us that they were had a hard time staying up. See, I'm gonna tell you something. I love y'all and I love people, but I don't put all my hope and trust in people, because people will go to sleep on you when you need them the most. They were straight. Oh, okay, what's going on? They went to sleep on Jesus. us. Everything that he did for them. The one time when he just told them, I need you and I need you now. Maybe Jesus had his Sony CD player and he was listening to Hezekiah Walker. I need you. You need me. At that time, whatever the case may be, he needed them to assist him, but they could not assist him. Jesus was in God and he had tension and he was struggling so much so that at that time we were able to see a glimpse of Jesus's humanity as he is both God and man. And Jesus said, Father, if it be, allow this cup of suffering. Allow it to pass from me. What he was saying metaphorically, of course, is I really in my flesh don't want to go through what I'm about to go through. But he called himself and he said, hold on now. Yeah. Not my will, but thy will be done. And that's the type of spirit that we have to operate with when we find in life at times, saying, Lord, I don't know if I can go through this suffering for your name. Say, we have to catch ourselves and say, Lord, not my will, but thy will be done. When the religious leaders came and they forcefully took Jesus from the Garden of Gethsemane, we are told that he was taken back to place with the religious leaders and Caiaphas as the high priest. We are told that the Roman soldiers spit on him. You know, one of the worst things you can do to somebody who you just don't like, who you despise, is to just spit on. When you spit on somebody, what you are saying is you are the scum of the earth. I hate you. You ain't nothing to me. When you spit on them, they spit on Jesus. And I ain't talking about the little spit when you driving in your car and you spit and the spit come back and hit you in the face or hit your child or somebody who in the back. I'm talking about they drenched him in saliva.
Come on now.
Text tells us that they punched him, physically assaulted him. Not little love taps that we be tapping each other with. I love you. No, they punched him. I'm talking about Mike Tyson punches. Evander Holyfield punches. As much pain as they could inflict on Jesus, we are told that they did so. We are told that Jesus stood there at his defense. And when the people told him, open up your mouth and say something. Aren't you going to defend yourself? Jesus kept silent. For Isaiah said, like a lamb before its shears, he did not open his mouth. They lied on him. Now, you know things are bad when two liars can't even get their story straight. Now, that's when you know they couldn't even lie on Jesus the right way. For the Bible says that each one of them story conflicted with each other. And when his fate had already been sealed, we are told that they led him away to Pilate. And when he got to Pilate, Pilate said, hold on now. Why are y'all bringing him to me? What has this man done? And when the people gave their sentence and they said that they didn't want the thief, the murderer, but they wanted Jesus to be crucified, Pilate took him on in the back and said, come on, we got to talk. Pilate looked at Jesus and the Bible said, he just said, who are you? What is going on? Jesus didn't say anything. You know, there is a time to speak in a time not to speak. Some of us need to learn that because we have found ourselves caught up in some webs that we shouldn't be in, all because we couldn't keep our mouth closed. Jesus kept his mouth closed. And then finally, Pilate said, don't you know who I am? I have the power to take you out right now. Don't you know at my word, at my command, I I can have you exonerated. Jesus looked at him and said, you don't have any power over me except the power that had been given unto you. Jesus was a bad brother. Could you imagine Pilate's face and all his pomp and circumstances, and he thinks he had it going on, and Jesus, this man from Nazareth, looked at him and said, you have no power over me except that it had been given to you. Jesus essentially said, listen, there's nothing you can do to me that has not already been foreordained before the foundations of the earth. And finally, when he went ahead and scourged Jesus. See, a lot of us, when we think about the crucifixion, we really don't take the time to try to understand, or we haven't done research to truly understand the suffering that in that particular time, when the Roman soldiers would scourge somebody, what they would do is they would take a wooden instrument that had leather strips on it, and from the tip of those strips, like this microphone, you had bone, metal, and glass that were on the tip. And what they would do is they would strip a person's clothes off, and they would tie their hands to a post, and the Roman soldiers would hit them, and when they would take their arm and come around and connect with the flesh of the individual, they would take it, twist their wrist, and rip it back. It has been documented that individuals who had been crucified, that you could actually see their spine because the flesh had been literally ripped off of their backs. Most people didn't even make it to the cross to be crucified, because when they were scourged, they literally died right there on the spot because the beating was that severe. They scourged Jesus, and while he was dripping in blood, put a robe on him, put a crown of thorns thrown on his head, and they mocked him, put a scepter in his hand. Oh, you the king, you thank you the king, look at you now. And then they had him carry his own crossbeam. We are told by scholars that Jesus did not actually carry the whole cross the way that the movies at times depict it, but that he actually carried the beam of the cross, that once you got to this place of skull of Golgotha's hill, they already had the cross there, and that the beam of the cross weighed at least 50 to 60 pounds. Could you imagine, with being as exhausted as he was, the blood that he lost, the sweat that he lost, how thirsty he was, putting that beam on his back and trying to carry it, that it was so much that the Bible says that they compelled a man who was just simply in town, just chilling, trying to enjoy the festivities. And they said, listen here, you come and you carry his cross. And as he walked down the Via Dolorosa sorrowfully, people on the street and kids looking and saying, Mom, why are they crucified? What are they doing? Why are they crucified? This is the same man who came in the town on the donkey, and we put down palms and we said, Hosanna, Hosanna. Now they're saying, crucify him. Why is he being condemned, baby? Bible tells us he got to the site. And if you think that he had experienced pain with all the other stuff, oh my Lord, the worst was yet to come.
All right.
For we are told, when we look at the method of Roman crucifixion, that they took 4 to 7 inch spikes. I'm not talking about them little nails that we use in our apartment, in our houses, when we try to put up our cute little pictures. I'm talking about spikes, thick spikes, that went through his wrist and hit his median nerve. Excruciating, shocking pain going throughout his body. And while all of this is going on, my Lord, he had me on his mind. He had you on his mind. He had the world on his mind as he suffered. They took two and put one in his left wrist and one in his right wrist. Did the same thing to his feet. But the thing that we must understand is that as Jesus tells us in the word, Jesus said this, no one takes my life from me. I have the power to lay it down and the power to take it back up. Now that's shouting news right there, because some of us, we look at Jesus and just say, oh man, Jesus was a wimp. Why he didn't do anything? Listen, if Jesus wanted to, scripture said he could have called legions of angels to come. He could have got down from the cross, but love kept him nailed up there on the cross. That's love. And as he hung on the cross, we are told that he uttered seven sayings. Now, the simple fact that Jesus could find enough strength to say seven sayings from the cross, it just shows you how determined he was to complete his mission. For we are told that Jesus really died, not of being crucified, but he died in that he suffocated. The fluid that built up on his lungs made it very difficult for him to speak. And see, when a person was crucified back then, they would take their feet and press it against the pole to try to hold themselves up. And we are told that while he was up there on that cross, he said seven sayings, and one of those sayings was, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And I'm going to be honest with you all, I still have a problem with that saying. Because I said to myself, Lord, how in the world, when your creations, for the Bible says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, the same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Your creations treated you with such disdain and disrespect and humiliated you, and you said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. In that moment, Jesus showed, and he shows us that he practiced what he preached. And at times in our own personal life, when people crucify us, we got to be able to just stand strong in the power of God and say, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing, Lord. They don't know what they are doing. Forgive them of their sins. And as he hung on that cross, he got to one of the sins and said, it is finished. Everything that I have been commissioned to do, the plan of salvation, making it possible so that you can be redeemed, so that I can be redeemed. Jesus said, I've done everything that's been required of me. And with that being said, he bowed his head. But before he bowed his head, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. There's no better hands to be in than to be in the hands of God. Could you imagine at that time when Jesus died, how they thought they had won? Could you imagine how Satan probably pounded his chest and said, we finally got him. We got the Son of God. He is dead. The religious leaders went back to their homes and their scriptures and went down and talked about, we finally got that rascal. He ain't gonna be teaching and preaching no more. He ain't gonna be healing anymore. He ain't gonna be talking about the kingdom anymore. But that's not how the story ends. Can you say amen? That the story did not end at Calvary. Amen. For the Bible tells us that when they took his body and they laid it in a borrowed tomb, and when they came back on Sunday morning, on Sunday morning, they came back to check on Jesus, and Jesus was not there. Where in the world did they take Jesus? The women said, Where is my Lord? And some angels standing there. Bible said, glory. Said, why are you here? Looking for Jesus. Why are you looking for the living among the dead? And I ask you the same question. Why are you looking for the living among the dead? We serve a living God. God is not dead. Bible said that at that moment they saw Jesus. Can you imagine the excitement when they saw their Lord and when they touched him and they saw that he was real? Jesus said, hold on now, I haven't ascended unto the Father. Just calm down. I know y'all excited, but I tried to tell you that I was coming back. Came back. Listen. Go down in the grave and get back up. Take a licking, get back up and keep on ticking. And I thank God today on this Resurrection Sunday that Jesus paid our bill in full. He didn't come into the store and say, I just want to go ahead and let me put them on layaway. Can I pay 3/4 of the bill? He said, no. Going to lay down my life, and I'm going to deliver them so that they can be free. Free to do what, Lord? Free to go to the club and drop it like it's hot? No, don't want to. Free to do what, Lord? To live my life for myself and do what I want to do? Free to do what, Lord? Free to worship me. Surrender your life to me. Free to draw closer in fellowship to me. Well, Lord, why? Because I paid your bill in full, and you ought to be grateful. And we can be some of the most ungrateful people at times. But when you understand what Jesus has done for us, you don't need nobody to pump you up and tell you come to church. You don't need nobody to tell you to pay your tithes and pay your offerings, because out of your devotion and your love for God, you're going to do it, and you're going to continue to do it. He paid the bill, and he paid it in full. And if you are grateful that he paid your bill in full and you accepted the salvation, will you stand to your feet and give God praise and glory on this Lord's Day, that the bill has already been paid in full? And Jesus said, guess what? You don't even have to leave no tip. I done already did that. Gave you the Holy Spirit to help us on our journey, to help us on our way. And on this Lord's Day, we recognize the sacrifice that Jesus made. He paid it all, and he paid it in full. Amen. Amen. Amen.